Thank you for watching Palestine Studies TV. I'm your host, William Yeomans. In today's episode, I'll be speaking with Yusuf Munayer, Executive Director of the Palestine Center, located here in Washington, D.C. He'll be speaking about a report he recently authored called When Settlers Attack, It Identifies Trends, Patterns, and also offers explanations for the rise in settler violence in the West Bank. My first question for you, Yusuf, is why did you write this report? What motivated it?
When we look at settler violence, we notice that particularly in the last several years, the number of incidents of settler violence has increased dramatically. In the past, it used to be seen as something that kind of happens as, you know, part of the many different violations of human rights and crimes that are ongoing in the occupied territories. But seeing the dramatic increase in recent years has led many people, including other international agencies, to look closer into settler violence as a phenomenon, how it's happening, where it's happening, why it's happening, particularly when you're seeing some of the dramatic numbers that we're seeing over the past several years. For example, from 2010 to 2011, we saw an increase of 39% in settler violence. 2010, in turn, had beat out 2009. For a record number of instances of settler violence. And in the past 5 years, we see a 315% increase in settler violence. So something is going on, and it's an issue that has become so central to the livelihood of Palestinians, because, you know, for a Palestinian who wants to travel from one village to the next, there's this constant specter of settler violence that they have to beware of. For a Palestinian that's going out into their fields or their orchards, their agricultural fields, there's this specter of settler violence that's hanging above their heads that they constantly have to worry about. With, of course, the number of instances, we're seeing the number of injuries go up, we're seeing the number of casualties go up, we're seeing the amount of property being damaged go up. So it's something that's taking a very high toll on the livelihood of Palestinians in the West Bank.
What are some of the key trends identified in the report?
There are three major trends that we wanted to highlight. The first, as I mentioned, is this sort of general trend over time. And what we look at with the help of about 7 years worth of daily data and over 3,700 different instances of settler violence during this time period is what that trend looks like over time. And as I mentioned, you see this very significant increase over the past 5 years, 315%, and it's an exponential sort of line. These numbers and graphs, of course, are documented within the report. We also note a geographic trend. And in the past, settler violence was something that we had seen more predominantly concentrated in the southern part of the West Bank, much of it in Hebron, for example, where you have Israeli settlers living really within the midst of, inside a Palestinian city in Hebron. That close proximity had a lot to do with the number of attacks that you saw. That's no longer the case. Geographically, we see a shift northward. We see Nablus now, a governorate in the north, taking on a much larger percentage of attacks, Qalqilya as well. And the fact that the sort of the theater of this violence has shifted from one that was predominantly urban in Hebron, where we've seen in the past, to one that is now much more rural, much more concentrated on attacks against villages instead of attacks within a city, tells you that there's something going on here that wasn't going on before, that there is an opportunity to attack villages that is being exploited as it wasn't before. So that geographic trend is an important one to point out. The final trend that we wanted to note is a trend in the type of tactics being used. We're seeing now an increase almost double the amount of arson attacks that we saw about 5 or 6 years ago. We're seeing also a dramatic increase in the number of stone-throwing attacks. And of course, an increase in attacks across the board, because they've consistently gone up year over year. But some of the attacks that are sort of more limited to attacks on villages or attacks on agriculture, we've seen go up. Whereas some of the attacks that we've seen on a more personal level that involve more proximity, like physical attacks, for example, beatings, those kinds of things, those have remained fairly constant or have gone down. And so the type of violence, the strategies of violence being employed by settlers are shifting.
Well, to what extent is settler influence in Israeli politics a factor here?
Well, I think one of sort of the misconceptions that arises when we talk about settler violence, particularly in the way it's portrayed within media coverage of these events, especially in the last couple years, is this sort of idea that the price tag events, which is something that we talk about in the report, this idea that settlers are reacting to actions of the Israeli state, is really misleading. In fact, it's settlers exploiting the inactions of the Israeli state that's allowing the vast majority of settler violence to take place. Upwards of 90% of all instances of settler violence take place in areas of the West Bank where it is the Israelis, not the Palestinians, that are responsible for security. And so this tells you it's a failure of the Israeli state's ability to protect Palestinian civilians that allows settler violence to take place. Now, as far as the politics of it goes, the Israelis, as the occupiers in the West Bank, have an obligation to protect the civilian population. Ultimately, the Israelis need to withdraw from the occupied territories and, of course, end all settlement building, dismantle the settlements, and so on. But the failure to do that in the interim does not absolve them of the responsibility to protect Palestinian civilians that have nothing to do with Israeli politics. This is an obligation that falls on them as the occupier. They are, through the Oslo framework and through essentially the use of force as an occupier, preventing Palestinians from protecting themselves. So if that is the case, if the Israelis are not going to allow the Palestinians to protect themselves and not going to fulfill their own obligations to protect Palestinian civilians in the occupied territories, you're going to continue to see this situation where Palestinians in these villages are essentially sitting ducks, where settlers are able to exploit these opportunities to attack them. And so I think there are things that the Israeli government can do. There are things that the American government can do. There are things that the Palestinian Authority can do to protect Palestinian civilians until there is a broader agreement on the situation. It should be clear that, you know, Palestinians facing settler violence on a daily basis is not an issue that should be put off until there's a broader agreement between Israelis and Palestinians about the future of the occupation and the negotiations between them. This is something that affects people on a daily basis, and there are practical steps that can be taken to change this. And part of that involves the Israelis actually fulfilling their obligations to protect Palestinian civilians. We know which settlements are the most dangerous settlements. We know which villages are the most vulnerable villages. It simply becomes an issue of policing at that point. You look, for example, in the Nablus district, there's a settlement called Yitzhar. Yitzhar is surrounded by Palestinian villages, which population-wise and territory-wise are larger than the Israeli settlement. Yet, even though they outflank it from every direction, outnumber it, and are stronger than it in terms of numbers, are constantly falling victim to attacks from that settlement. Why? Because a settler from Yitzhar can walk less than a mile away to any one of these villages, unimpeded. But a Palestinian cannot enter the territory of that settlement because there's a security perimeter, there's security guards, and so on and so forth. These are the kind of things that need to exist to protect Palestinians from settlers, as well as the other way around, you know, and they don't, and that's the problem. and Palestinians are not permitted by the Israeli occupier to provide this kind of security. And so essentially what you have in this situation is the Israelis creating a situation where Palestinians are consistently vulnerable to Israeli settlers.
Here in the U.S., we'll see occasional reports of Palestinian violence against Israeli settlers. To what extent does Palestinian violence explain this rise in Israeli settler violence?
While those arguments may be made, they don't pan out when you look at the numbers. As the report states, over the past 5 years, you have this significant increase in settler violence, 315% in terms of the number of instances. And during the same period of time in the West Bank, you see a 95% decrease in Palestinian violence. And so just looking at those two numbers side by side tells you that that's probably not what the situation is. But we went further than that. And what we decided to do was looking at instances of Palestinian violence and instances of settler violence. We tried to determine what's the correlation between them. What causes what? Is there a sort of chicken and egg effect here? Or are they not related at all? And what we found, interestingly, is that there is a relationship between Palestinian violence and settler violence. But it's, in fact, a negative relationship. So there's not a responsorial relationship in the sense that if there's an event of instance of Palestinian violence, you see an increase in settler violence. You actually see a decrease in settler violence. But what we've also found is the number of instances in which this is the case is very small. And so while it explains a very small percentage of settler violence, and in this case a decrease in settler violence, it still doesn't tell us much about the overall phenomenon. And so a lot of that is the product of the fact that settler violence is going up while Palestinian violence is going down. So there's clearly something else going on here.
Now, what are the implications for U.S. foreign policy? Is the State Department, for example, bringing this up with Israeli diplomats? Is there any sort of American interest in this issue?
We certainly hope so. In recent years, it's gained a lot more of attention internationally because the number of instances of settler violence have gone up. And some of the types of the attacks that we've seen have been more sensational. In the past, we'd seen a lot of stone-throwing incidents, shooting incidents, vehicular attacks, and so on. Now we're seeing a lot more arson attacks, which are covered differently in terms of the media. We've occasionally seen attacks where the settlers are attacking Israeli targets as well, including Israeli peace activists, including even IDF bases. So the fact that the types of attacks have taken actions against different targets has brought a little bit more attention to this issue. Overall, however, it is the Palestinians as people and their property, whether it is their fields, whether it is their houses, their mosques, their churches, what have you, that are the ultimate victims, the overall victims of Israeli settler violence. And we hope that putting together this report, putting together these findings, can advance the discussion about settler violence and begin to make policymakers think about a efficient way of responding to the issue and tackling it head on.
Yusuf, I just want to thank you for taking time to be with us on Palestine Studies TV.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
If you're interested in the report When Settlers Attack, you can get it from the Palestine Center's website, www.thejerusalemfund.org. And while you're online, make sure to visit the Institute for Palestine Studies website as well, www.palestine-studies.org. And while you're there, please donate to the Institute for Palestine Studies so we can continue to provide fresh and original programming for you. Thank you.